Thank you. Let us bow our heads before we begin our opening hymn. Heavenly Father, we ask that you will be with our praise and that our hearts will be tuned to sing your praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Turn with me in your hymnals to hymn number 341, To God Be the Glory. And please remember that you are a reflection of him as you sing. Stand, you can stand with me.
To God be the glory, great things he had done, so loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord.
Good morning, everyone, and happy Sabbath to each and every one of you. As I was thinking about the dedicatory prayer, as I heard Brother Dean speaking about the Edenic school, and then he talked about Solomon, I was meditating this morning about God's people in Israel coming together at the dedication of the temple. And so we are coming together this year at the beginning of this new school term and of this school year to dedicate ourselves, not just a literal building, but each and every one of us as temples to the Lord. And I thought that that would be a very fitting thing to have in our memories as we will soon kneel in prayer. And as I thought about that, I also thought about the closing emphasis of Jesus in the last few hours that he had when he would be gone from his disciples, that he spoke a lot about the Holy Spirit. And so we desperately need him in each and every one of our lives. And so I would just ask that those that are able will kneel with me as we pray and dedicate this new school year to the Lord. Let's kneel. Our gracious, loving Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you so much for the privilege that you have given to us this year. We thank you for this new school term. And as the children of Israel dedicated themselves to the God of Israel at the dedication of the temple, Lord, we are here, assembled here this morning to dedicate ourselves to you. Father, I would first like to begin with us as administrators, faculty, and staff. Lord, we pray that we would indeed be living epistles, known first of all to our immediate family members, and then to our students, and to whomsoever we come in contact with. Lord, help us to realize that whatever experiences and education we have had in the past, it's not sufficient for the challenges and the duties that you have for us today. Lord, we desperately need your Holy Spirit, for we can only impart that which we receive. And we pray that each and every day we would fall on the rock and be broken and be baptized and filled with your Holy Spirit. May we be awake and attentive to your providential leading in the lives of our students. Lord, we also want to dedicate our students here this morning. Many of them have left their country, their kindred, and their father's house. There will be challenges, many. There will be times where they will be lonely. There will be times when they will be afraid. There will be times when they will be discouraged and ready to give up. And I pray that at each and every one of those times, they may discern in you a helping friend. May your Holy Spirit lead them and guide them. May they remember that it was you that called them to be here. Oh, Lord, we desperately need your Holy Spirit. We pray that this year would not be the same as other years. I pray that just as Solomon had ended his prayer and that you had manifested yourself in a very marked way, I pray that you would also manifest yourself through the impartation of your Holy Spirit this year to every person here. And Lord, we also want to lift up our speaker, Brother Dean. We thank you for the messages that he has shared. And as he is here preaching, I know his mind is back home in California, where the fires are raging. And we pray that your Holy Spirit would lift up a standard, that he would say this far and this far only, as we remember our sister college, Weimar, as they are facing the engulfing flames. So thank you, Father. Thank you for all that you have done for us in the past, and we anticipate the rich blessing of your Holy Spirit imparted to us this year. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
In Isaiah chapter 6, verse 8, it says, "Also I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then said I, Here am I, send me." So the title of my song is "I Will Go," and I pray that whatever God calls you to do, or wherever He calls you to go, maybe your answer will always be, "I will go."
Give me ears to hear your Spirit. Give me feet to follow through. Give me hands to touch the hurting and the thief to follow you. Give me grace to be a servant. Give me mercy for the lost. Give me passion for your glory. Give me passion for the cross. And I will go where there are no easy roads. Leave the comforts that I know. I will go and let this journey be my home. I will go. I will go. Go of my ambition, cut the roots that run too deep. I will learn to give away what I cannot really keep, what I cannot really keep. See with eyes of faith, give me strength to run this race, and I will go where there are no easy roads. Leave the comforts that I know. I will go journey be my home. I will go, Lord, where your glory is honored. I will live for you, Lord. I will go because my life is not my home. I will go. I will go. I will go.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus is looking for followers. Song, right?
Amen.
That's very touching. And all of you in Hartland staff students also have accepted the call to go and to come here and to give ourselves to God in gratitude to what He has done in our life and what He's going to do. So this is our time for Hartland Benevolent fun time. And this is, as you all know, there are regular Hartland staffs who get regular stipend to support for their basic needs, but we also have some volunteers who sacrificially give their time and from their efforts and who are still here serving cheerfully. So this time we just want to honor them and give something tangible to help them with whatever they may be needing in their lives. And so at this time I would like to invite all the deacons to come to the front, and we're going to have our prayer. Let's have a word of prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for this beautiful Sabbath day you've given us and the opportunity to gather together as a Hartland family and to worship you in spirit and truth. And Lord, at this time as we give, Lord, help us to give out of our hearts, for you love a cheerful giver. And bless this offering that we're giving for the Heartland volunteers. We're giving very sacrificially this place. Thank you so much. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. So today I will be reading out of New King James Version, and the scripture reading is Ephesians 1, verses 10. Ephesians 1, verses 10. That in the dispensation of the fullness of the times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are on earth. In him.
Thank you, Abigail, John Andy, Hannah, for assisting us in this worship service. Just wanted to make sure I didn't, our musicians, thank you. Appreciate that. Just wanting to reintroduce our speaker, Dean Cullinane, and if you were really listening this morning, I think all of us pretty much got shellacked and challenged this morning. And that's why we're here, to be informed, to be challenged. And as I mentioned in my prayer, he's here, but the fires are raging back home. And so please uplift him, his family, our family at Weimar, as they are. I think I just spoke to him not too long ago. He said they're not in the path of the flames, but anything can change at a moment's notice. So we are truly grateful that in this context that he took the time to come here to speak to us, to challenge us, to inspire us regarding what our purpose is. He is the dean at Weimar Academy, and if he had a nickel for every time someone told him he was rightly named, he'd be driving an even better car than he is right now. So we just want to thank the Lord for him accepting the challenge, and we are looking forward to what he is going to share with us, what the Lord has laid on his heart.
The fire back home is pretty big, but I guess my prayer for this morning is that the fire here in our hearts would be even greater, that we would, as the disciples on the road to Emmaus experienced, that we would have a burning experience where we come into contact with Jesus Christ. Amen? The Bible tells us that we will burn forever. You know this, right? That God's people, that it is not those that are destroyed by the hellfire that burn forever, but it is God's people that dwell in his presence that will live in that glorious fire forever. So fire can be a good thing, amen? As it purifies us, just as the trials of life do. I want to just extend my appreciation to the leadership of your institute and the members, the faculty that have been involved in getting me here. Both Veronica and Julie, though I don't see them right now, have been awesome, and I really appreciate them in how they've helped me as I've navigated this little trek across the country. I was going to come with my wife and my son. My wife and I have been married since 2014, so 8 years. We met when I was 15 and she was 13. She was the one that, she is the one that was responsible for bringing me to the Lord. The Lord used her in a mighty way when I was 18 years old and she was just 16 to bring me into the church. And we're grateful. She's often said that God used her to win me, to use me to win her. And we've been trying to keep each other on the straight and narrow ever since. And I do wish that she could have been here, but with the situation back home, we decided it would be best if she remained, just in case there was an evacuation and she was able to leave. And she's also pregnant, which we're very excited about, with our second son. And we have a 14-month-old son called Wolfgang. Mozart's first name was Wolfgang, but that's not where it comes from. There was a gentleman that came to Weimar and did a seminar on music. His name is Wolfgang Stefani. And I sat down that seminar, I just thought, what a cool name. Wouldn't it be amazing to have a son called Wolfgang? And my wife disagreed, shockingly. And so essentially I went to her kind of how God came to Solomon with carte blanche, blank check. What do you want in return for me being able to call my son Wolfgang? And so we wrote up a contract, I kid you not, that had conditions of all of these things that I had to do in order for that to be his name. And now that's his name. I signed the contract in the presence of two witnesses. I have it framed just as a remembrance. And so we have Wolfgang Alpha Cullinane. Alpha because we wanted a Bible name and because he's the first. So he's got a cool, strong name. We're looking forward to the next one on the way. I would say without a shadow of a doubt that the greatest indication of God's goodness and love to me has been through what Jesus has done, but through also the family that he has blessed me with. So those of you that are privileged to have families of your own, wives, children, husbands, parents, siblings, these people have been put in your life by God for good reason. And so make sure that they feel cherished and that they feel loved and appreciated. And I'm sure they'll make you feel the same way. But they do. My wife does say hi. She wishes she could be here to see you all. Maybe that will happen another time. Who knows? This morning, I have a question for you. This whole sermon is based on a question. And it's not so much a question that I'm asking as much as it is a question that God is asking. Friend, why have you come? Why are you here? And so throughout this sermon, we're going to look at times in Scripture where God asked that question. And that's just fascinated me. I don't know if you ever thought about this, that God asks questions. That God, who knows all things, asks questions. I wonder if God has ever asked a non-rhetorical question. I don't think so, because he knows the answer. But we will be looking at those questions and seeing what perhaps God might be asking us. So let's have prayer. Dear Father in heaven, Lord, we are incredibly grateful because you have not left us here in the wilderness wandering alone. You have given us your word. You have given us all that you would say to us. And Father, I am incredibly grateful for the power of your Holy Spirit to bring these words to life. And it's that what we pray for this afternoon. For a double portion even, Lord, if that is your will. That our hearts would be set aflame. That we would be overflowing with love and gratitude for what you have done for us. That we would have an answer to this question. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Jesus had a mission. Can you say amen? This mission is outlined first and foremost, I think, in Genesis chapter 3, where the very first prophecy is given that Satan's head should be crushed under the heel of the seed of the woman. And so his mission is outlined from the very onset of Scripture, that he is going to come and be a deliverer. This is elaborated further as we go throughout the Scripture. We're given hints and clues as to where he will come and when he will come and from whence he will come, whose tribe he will come from, so on and so forth. And by the time he comes, as we're told in Isaiah, he comes to his own and his own what? Receive him not. In fact, they don't even recognize him. And the reason is because as we pass through the generations, as we discussed this morning, each successive school fails at its mission, its primary mission of readying its people to meet the Lord. So it's no surprise that when he comes, they don't know who he is. They don't recognize him. The vast majority of people turn away from him, look at him as a disgrace, as a false prophet, some even going as far as to call him the devil himself. The disciples are kind of caught in this mix. They are the ones that say that they do believe, but they're also the ones whose actions often testify otherwise. They thought, in accepting to follow Jesus, that he would come and save them from their persecution. Save them from Roman jurisdiction. Save them from their current and present trials. In actual fact, you and I know well that that is not at all why Jesus came. He came to save them from their sin. But why did they think that? Why was that where their mind went? I think we do the same thing. This is exactly what happens when you put your wants before your needs. That your perspective is altered. What do I want? I want for these people to no longer be over me. I want to not have to be told that I must do this and I must go there and so on and so forth. Whereas what we actually need is deliverance. They neglected the true study of the Scripture. And yet, Jesus called them. Jesus called them to ministry. And when you look at the profiles of the disciples, it is quite shocking. I sit on the applications committee at Weimar Academy. It's not called that, but that's essentially what it is. Whereas students apply, I'm part of the interviewing process naturally as the dean. And then we have to vote through and accept as to whether they come or not. And I often think if one of the disciples had applied, would we have accepted them? I don't know. Genuinely, I don't know. Like, if we had James and John apply, I don't know. I'll be honest. I don't know. Do they love the Lord? Yes. Do they love the Lord? Yes. Do they love the Lord so much that they're willing to take you out? Yes. I don't know. Would they be accepted? If there's one disciple, though, that would definitely have been accepted, it would be Judas. Oh, Judas was like the model student, no? Judas was the one that knew the Scripture so well. Judas was the one that was able to think long term, you know, to think about the planning, to think not just about where they are and their present struggles, but to really think about where they could go, the potential, the big picture. Judas was in many ways the leader of the disciples. He was the one that they looked to outside of Christ. They looked at him and thought, if anyone knows Jesus, that's the guy, Judas. It's weird saying that, though, isn't it? Judas. Like, the good disciple, Judas. It's like, we've heard his name in a negative, with a negative connotation for so often. That like, no one is, you think Wolfgang's a weird name. No one's calling their son Judas. Right? Maybe Judah. We can get away with Judah, Lion of the Tribe of Judah and so on. Is there a Judas here, by the way? Okay, just checking. That would have been awkward. You don't call your son Judas. Just because of what it means, how it carries. But Jesus called Judas, knowing who he was. All of the disciples, the one thing that they had in common was they had this very nationalistic view that Jesus was going to come and he was going to just overthrow the Roman government and life was going to be great. That if you just get rid of your oppressors, that life would be awesome. Which is absolute nonsense, by the way. If you've ever traced this through history, whenever one oppressive group is removed, they're simply just replaced by another. This is the history of Israel. The history of Israel is occupation. The history of Israel is being ruled, if not by the Philistines, then one of the many ites. And if not by the ites, then the Romans. And if they had got rid of the Romans, they were so used to being slaves, weak and oppressed, that if they were not conquered by another nation, it is likely a group within would have risen up and conquered them. They did not understand that Christ was not coming as king. That as we sang about just before Sabbath school this morning, that there was multiple roles that he had to fill. First as prophet, then as priest, and then as king. As a prophet outlined in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 39, when he answered and said unto them, "An evil and adulterous generation seeks a sign, and there shall be no sign given to it but the sign of the prophet Jonah," foreshadowing his life and death for 3 days. "Behold," he says, "one greater than Jonah is here." Have you ever thought about Jonah? Jonah's a fascinating prophet. Since we live in an age where statistics and data rule all, Jonah must sit atop when it comes to the glory of the prophets. Jonah is the greatest. No one comes close. He has a 100% conversion record. You ever thought about that? He walks into Nineveh, the most wicked of cities, and preaches. I don't know if you've read the sermon, but it's not a very hopeful one. Preaches to them that unless they repent, and he didn't even want to include that part, that they are going to be goners. And 100% of the people convert. That's Jonah. Good old faithful Jonah, right? Statistics can often skew our understanding. Do you know who Jesus says the greatest prophet is? John the Baptist. Compare his conversion rate with that of Jonah. I don't think it's very high. They had a similar style, though, I imagine. Matthew chapter 12, verse 5 and 6. "Or have you not read in the law how that on the Sabbath days the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple." So there's one here greater than the greatest of your prophets. There's one here that is greater than the greatest of your temples. And again in Matthew chapter 12 and verse 42, "The queen of the south shall rise up in the judgment with this generation and shall condemn it. For she came from the uttermost parts of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, a greater than Solomon is here." Jesus says, "I have come as prophet, I will come as priest, and I will then come as king." greater than any prophet you have seen, greater than any priest you have seen, greater than any king you have seen. He outlined these things to them. Listen, he said, I want you to understand, I'm going to be here now as a prophet, directly the actual speaker of the word of God, the mouthpiece of God. That is my role now. Do you understand? And they're like, then I'm going to be the priest, okay? I'm going to be greater than even the great temple that was built here, okay? Do you get that? And then I'm going to come as king. Then I'm going to come as king, all right? Okay, so tell me what you've understood. That you're going to come as king. That's the disciples for you. That you're going to come as king. That's all they wanted. Jesus knew this. The Bible says in John chapter 6 and verse 15, therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to take him by force and make him king, he departed again to the mountain by himself alone. Luke chapter 9, verse 55 and 56, the Bible says, but he turned to them and rebuked them and said, you do not know what manner of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, i.e. the Romans, but to save them. And so they went off to another village. Jesus's message was that the kingdom of God was coming. And that excited the people. But what he was trying to teach them was that the kingdom of God is within you. Not that it is afar off on a distant cloud and is about to rest atop Rome. But that the purpose of the gospel, listen to me, that the purpose of the gospel is not to take you to a place. That the purpose of the gospel is to put that place in you. That if you are to be fit to enter heaven, then heaven must first have entered you. That if you are going to spend eternity with Jesus there, that you ought to spend your life with him here first. That the kingdom of God is within you. What did they hear? That Rome was going down. I believe that this was Satan's plan all along. To blind the Jewish people's eyes to the scriptures and to the reality of who the Savior was, and to push him towards taking control, civilly speaking. Hence why when it came to the temptation in Matthew chapter 4, verses 8 through 10, it says again, the devil took him up to an exceedingly high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory and said to him, all of these things I will give you if you what? If you fall down and worship me. Jesus, the throne can be yours. Your people can have salvation from the Romans. They don't get it though. Peter, when Jesus tells him plainly that he's going to die, listen to what I'm about to say. Peter rebukes Jesus. That's some boldness right there. To believe that this is the Son of God, and yet at the same time, that he has somehow misunderstood his mission. Peter rebukes Jesus. The Bible says in Matthew chapter 16 and verse 21, from that time forth began Jesus to show his disciples. You see, sometimes we think that Jesus was very cryptic and they just had no idea. Listen, to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised again the third day. That doesn't sound symbolic. That doesn't sound cryptic. That doesn't sound like he was trying to hold things back from them. He was spelling it out. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not happen to thee. And so, as you know well, he turns to Peter and says, get thee behind me, Satan. You are an offense unto me, for you savor not the things of God, but the things that are of men. And as much as that was what was told to Peter, I think it is something that aptly describes the very life of Judas. That you savor not the things of God, but the things of men. Judas, as we know in Scripture, was a lover of money, a lover of self, an ambitious man who wanted nothing more than Jesus to be on the throne so that he could be sitting next to him. My wife and I, we honeymooned in South Africa. I was telling Peter this yesterday. We were broke when we got married. It is possible. We had a very budget wedding, and we weren't planning on having a honeymoon because broke. We got a call from a church in Johannesburg, South Africa, and they said, can you come over and preach an evangelistic series for us for 3 weeks? I was like, 3 weeks, that's a long time. I said, listen, that sounds amazing. I've been to Africa a few times before, never South Africa. That sounds amazing, I'd love to, but I'm going to be like 3 days married by the time that starts, so I don't think it's going to work out. And then they messaged me back and said, that's fine. Come on over. Consider this your honeymoon. You'll come over. You can stay for 4 weeks if you want. So you can have a week here in South Africa, and then you can do the evangelistic series together for 3 weeks. And we were like, all right, here we go. And we went over there, and it was fascinating. One of our best experiences as a married couple in ministry. And plus, South Africa is just incredibly beautiful. We just fell in love, whether we were in Johannesburg, whether we were in Cape Town, wherever it was just beautiful. Whilst we were there, or it was around about that time, it was a while ago, so sometimes my timelines get mixed up. But there was an athlete, I don't know if any of you have heard of him, his name was Oscar Pistorius. He's an athlete that has prosthetic legs, and from South Africa, and was a national hero by all accounts. Not just a national hero, but a global hero. This man was revered by so many. A poster boy for disabled Olympians and what people can achieve if they put their mind to it and all of these kind of things. He killed his girlfriend. Shot her in their home multiple times. And there was this huge trial taking place. And he was convicted of murder and sent down. And his story, for me, kind of paralleled that of Judas. Because had it not been for the revealed final moments of Jesus' life, this man would be celebrated. He would be honored and revered. We would have St. Judas. We'd have schools named after Judas. And he would be the topic of many of our Bible studies. He would be looked at as a genuine Christian. Judas did not change in the final moments. Who he was simply revealed in the final moments. I often think how good God is, that he doesn't reveal how we actually are to others. Can you say amen? Amen? But that he works on us and he doesn't give up on us. That oftentimes he's patient and kind and loving and he waits. Because God's ideal is at the end of time, he would reveal who you are and there others would see Jesus. Now sometimes along this perhaps disciplining or refining process, things must be brought to the light. With Judas, I believe he had decided long ago that he was going to betray his master. He is the perfect example of why books should not be judged by their covers. Well, perhaps that's not a good thing to say because we judge books by their covers all the time. That's why covers are there, to be judged. I don't know if you've ever realized that, but that's the purpose of covers. But not being able to judge another man's heart, Judas is proof of that. There's a song in the hymnal, one of my favorites. I will follow thee, my Savior, wheresoever thou may lead. Where thou goest, I will follow. Yes, my Lord, I'll follow thee. Love that hymn. I don't know this for sure, but I think I know where that song comes from in the scriptures. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 18 through 20, The Bible says, now when Jesus saw great multitudes about him, he gave commandment to depart unto the other side. And a certain scribe came unto him and said unto him, Master, I will follow thee wheresoever thou goest. Jesus says unto him, the foxes have holes and the birds have air. Sorry, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Ellen White says that this scribe was Judas. That Judas was the one that came to Jesus and says, Master, I will follow thee wherever you go. Jesus, knowing Judas's heart, tried to reveal to him the humble walk of ministry. Listen, I know what you're thinking. I know why you're in this. I know what you hope to gain. I want you to know that the foxes and the birds are going to have a better time than my followers. We're not even going to have somewhere to sleep. I will follow thee wherever thou goest. I find it ironic that Judas says that he will go wherever Christ leads. And then the moment that Christ starts to lead, Judas says, that's where we can't go. I'll follow you anywhere, but not there. He assumed that Christ was going to be king, not killed. He joined the fold for the benefits, not for the sacrifices. And even when approached, and Jesus saying, one of you will betray me, Judas answering first, is it I, Lord? Is it me? You can imagine when they entered Jerusalem that the disciples started to get excited. Oh, here we go. The triumphant entry, as it's called, of the king. The disciples at this point are in heaven. Woo! Here we go. This is it. And then Jesus heads into Jerusalem. He goes to the top of the mount, and this is the moment to just stand before everyone and say, aha, now here is my kingdom. Instead, of course, he goes up and weeps, cries over them because of their pitiful state. He moves from Jerusalem, from the mount to the Garden of Gethsemane, praying, please, Lord, let this cup pass from me. While his disciples slept. But notice that when they wake up, what are they ready to do? They're ready to kill a man if need be. Peter chops off a man's ear. Do you know what Peter was? He was a fisherman, not a swordsman. Inspiration tells us that Peter wasn't aiming for the ear. If you know what I mean. Their priorities were straight. They were focused, even in these final moments, on their own mission. No, you can't take our master. Not because he's going to the cross, but because he's going to the throne. This is why Jesus, in John chapter 18, asks them, why are you defending me? And I think there's something in this. Jesus says to them, Peter specifically, and I love the way the Gospels work together. When Matthew's talking about the story, he's like, and one of the disciples chopped off a man's ear. And then John comes and John's like, yeah, that was Peter. And so Jesus says, and this I think could be a sermon alone. Do you think I need your help? Do you think I need your help? It's a rhetorical question. The answer is meant to be self-evident. No. I don't need your help to accomplish my mission. And I often think about that. That Jesus doesn't need my help. That this mission is going to be accomplished one way or another. My part is to decide whether I'm going to be on his side, whether I'm going to listen to his voice, whether I'm going to do as he asks me to do and follow his will. I'm not helping God. I'm not doing something that God couldn't ask someone else to do or something that he couldn't do himself. Sometimes we like to big ourselves up. Oh yeah, here, we're doing the work of the Lord. No one's really doing it like us. Yeah, no, we got it down to a T. Do you think God needs your help? I don't think he does. Praise the Lord that there are people that have signed up for his mission, that are doing his work. But that work is spiritual in nature, not carnal. That work will not be accomplished with swords and shields. It will be accomplished through genuine service of the heart, a commitment to truly follow Jesus wherever it is that he's leading. Judas, yeah, that's not going to work for Judas. Matthew chapter 26 is where I want to take you. This is where we ask the question. In Matthew chapter 26 and verse 47, the Bible reads, "And while he was still speaking, behold, Judas, one of the 12, with a great multitude with swords and clubs, came from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now his betrayer had given them a sign, saying, 'Whomever I kiss, he is the one, seize him.' Immediately he went up to Jesus and said, 'Greetings, Rabbi,' and kissed him. But Jesus said unto him, 'Friend, why have you come? Why have you come?'" This is one of those stories where I'm reminded how much I need Jesus. Because if I knew that one of my closest friends was going to betray me, or had already betrayed me, was going to get me sold as a slave to accomplish his own interests, and knowing that, he walks up to me and kisses me on the cheek, greets me, and says, "Greetings, Dean." I'll be honest with you guys, the last thing that's coming out of my mind, out of my mouth, is "friend." Ah, friend, good to see you. It amazes me that in this moment, with all of the ensuing chaos that is happening, Jesus has just sweat blood. He's just been told by God, "No, there's no other way. You're going to have to die. And yeah, it's going to be real bad." He's had his best friends, who he's been with for 3 years, training for this moment, that are about to flee for their own lives. He's had one of his closest sell him for the price of a slave. He's had another one of his closest try and kill a man and chop off his head. And in that moment, amidst all of that chaos, he looks at Judas and says, "Friend, why are you here? Why have you come? What has brought you to this moment?" I find it fascinating that at that time, the master teacher asks his student a reflective question. A reflective question. And so I ask myself, okay, are there other times in Scripture where this happens? Where something bad is about to happen and God gets involved and asks questions? And so if we go to the book of Genesis chapter 3, we see this play out wonderfully. Adam and Eve have fallen to temptation. The Bible says that at this time, 100% of the earth's population are Satanists. You with me? They have aligned themselves with the enemy. They have said, "We will trust your word above the word of God." Eve falling first to deception, and then becoming Satan's evangelist, seeking out her husband, convincing him that this was the right thing to do. And Adam not being deceived, which is why we are suffering from the consequences of Adam and not necessarily Eve. He was not deceived. He knew what had taken place. And he made the willful choice, saying, "If we're going to die, I would rather I did not lose my wife." I would rather we went down together. You can read that in Patriarchs and Prophets and the story of redemption. And so they hide themselves. They run. Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they saw that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves coverings. And when they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. They have just sinned. They have committed this monstrosity of choosing to align themselves with the devil over God. They know they've done wrong, and now they've been caught. Now they can hear the teacher walking to the room where they were just in doing that thing that they shouldn't have been doing. And so they hide themselves. Because that's the first thing you do, right, when you've been caught, is you try to cover it up in the hope that it will go amiss and no one will realize what's just taken place. But I want you to pay special attention to how God deals with this disciplinary issue. What's the first thing that he says? What is it? Can you see in the scripture? What does it say? Where are you? Where are you? Adam, because he's responsible, where are you? So Adam says, I heard your voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree which I commanded that you should not eat? Then the man said, the woman whom you gave to be with me, she gave me of the tree and I did eat. And then the Lord God said to the woman, so he's spoken to Adam, now he's speaking to Eve, what is this that you have done? This is how God deals with issues. His first and foremost thought is not, what did you do? Did you ever get that as a kid? Got yourself in trouble, did something that you weren't meant to do, and then mom or dad comes in, what did you do? And then you cower and think, I'm dead. At least that was my experience. That's not God's way. The first question that God asks is, where are you? Not geographically. God knows where they are. He knows they're just in that bush over there, covered by some fig leaves. You can probably see them. Where are you? Where are you? Where are you up here? What would lead you to make such a decision? I found that this approach, especially when dealing with young people, has an incredible success rate. I come to them and say, listen, right now, I don't care what you did. I care about you. I care about you. Tell me, where are you? What's going on? Let's get some context here. We have to eventually get to the situation. But where are you right now? What might lead you to make such a decision? Maybe if it was just willful disobedience, and we'll deal with that then. But for all I know, there's something happening. There's struggles that are going on. There's things happening at home. There's things happening in the dorm. There's things happening in the classroom. I want to know where you are. That's God. This is God, our first time seeing God as an evangelist. Stepping into hostile territory, trying to win back souls that have left him. And his first, his priority, his method is first, where are you? And then when that has been established, okay, now, let's talk. What have you done? This is successful, by the way. It's a successful approach. God's method of evangelism, of meeting the people where they're at, of spending time with them, getting to know them, becoming acquainted with their griefs and their sorrows. Christ's method alone, she calls it. Knowing that the relationship, first and foremost, is the bedrock so that you can then move on to say, follow me. That was Jesus' method, and so it should be ours. And so God comes to Adam and asks this question, where are you? He comes to Eve and says, what is this thing that you have done? He asks questions because he knows in asking those questions that they're going to be able to reflect. Where are you, Adam? Well, I'm hiding from you, God. I'm hiding from you. Why? Because I'm afraid. Because I've forgotten who you are, how good you've been to me. I believe Satan's lie that you're just out here for justice and judgment. I've forgotten that you are also a God of love. And so I hid myself. What have you done, Eve? Well, the serpent deceived me. Do you know what question God asks the serpent? Don't look. No question. No question. You know why? Because Satan had his time to answer those questions. Satan had his time to come clean. Satan had his opportunities for forgiveness. So he gets no question. The serpent is cursed. The prophecy is given that Satan will be defeated. And that's that. So what does that tell you about the fact that God's asking questions for Adam and Eve? That there's hope. Whenever God is asking questions, there's hope. Remember that. Genesis chapter 16. Genesis chapter 16. Verse 1, now Sarah, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children. And she had an Egyptian maidservant whose name was what? Hagar. So Sarah said to Abraham, see now, the Lord has restrained me from bearing children. Please, go into my maid. Perhaps I should obtain children by her. And he heeded the voice of Sarah. This, I wish I had time to go into the ramifications of that decision, of the offspring of Hagar and the problems that were caused from not waiting on God. Hagar flees. She flees Abraham. She flees the protection of his custody. She takes Ishmael with her, and she is on a road that leads nowhere good until she's approached by the angel of the Lord, who comes to her, and Ellen White gives us insight that this was Jesus, that comes to her and asks her two questions. Where have you come from? And where are you going? Those two questions, I think, combined really are the guidelines to life. Where have you come from? What's that pointing to? Your past. What's your story? Where are you? Where have you? What are you leaving behind on this journey? And where are you going now? If you were to ask those two questions every time you found yourself in some sort of conundrum, difficult situation, where you're not sure whether to trust in God in this situation or whether to just move ahead of your own accord, ask yourself those questions. Where have you come from? Look back. What has God done in your life to get you to this point? And where are these decisions going to take you? What's the trajectory that you are setting your life on here? Hagar, you're not alone. You've never been alone. I've been with you. I am with you. I am your God, just as I am Abraham's God. Where are you going? Where have you come from? The next time that I think God asks such a question is in 1 Kings chapter 19. These are the days of Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 19. I love this chapter. 1 Kings chapter 19, verse 1, and Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done and how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, "So let the gods do to me and more also if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow around this time. I'll let you know exactly when you're going to go." And when he saw that, he arose and ran for his life and went to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. He fled from his post of duty because Jezebel threatened him. Bear in mind that this is not our introduction to Elijah. Elijah has been used in some of the most miraculous ways we've ever heard of prior to this moment. But when that woman stands up and lets him know that he's a goner, he goes. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree, and he prayed that he might die and said, "It is enough. I'm done. Now, Lord, take my life, for I am no better than my father's. I'm as good as dead. Lord, just kill me." Today we call these suicidal thoughts. Take my life. I'm done. I don't want to suffer this way anymore. This life's too hard. I don't think I can do it. I don't know how to deal with this. This is too much for me. Then, I love this part. Then as he lay and slept under a broom tree, suddenly an angel touched him and said to him, "Get up and eat." And he's okay after that. Saw this thing online once that definitely rings true. To not make these kind of decisions when you're upset and angry. And if you find yourself losing control, take a nap, have a snack, and you'll be all right. I found that to be true. Sometimes when I'm upset, I just need to go to sleep. I just need to have a little nap, and then I'll wake up, maybe have a good granola bar, and then just get back to work. And it doesn't seem that bad anymore. Then he looked, and there by his head was a cake baked on coals and a jar of water, so he ate and drank and then took another nap. And the angel of the Lord came back to him a second time and said, "Arise and eat." So in reality, sometimes you need two naps and two snacks. Who says no to that? "Arise and eat, because the journey is too great." In other words, there's still work to be done, Elijah. This is not the end of your story. So he arose again. He's very obedient. And he ate and he drank and he went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights as far as Horeb, the mountain of God. And there he went into a cave and spent the night in that place. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him and said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Again, the question comes from God. What are you doing here? Why are you in this cave hiding from that woman? Don't you remember who I am? Don't you know what I have done through you? And Elijah, you don't know what I'm going to do through you. The keys within this chapter all point to the fact that Elijah was suffering with depression. Genuine depression. Look at verse 11. Then he said, "Go out. Stand on the mountain before the Lord, and behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore into the mountains and broke the rocks in pieces before the Lord, but the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice." So it was when Elijah heard it that he wrapped his face in the mantle and went out, stood in the entrance of the cave, and suddenly a voice came to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Now, Elijah has an answer. Oh, different. He says, "I have been zealous for the Lord God of hosts because your children of Israel have forsaken you and your covenant. They've torn down your altars. They've killed your prophets with the sword. And I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. In other words, God, it's just me. No one else is being faithful, just me. Everyone else has left, and it's just me now. I'm the only one that remains, Lord. Depression will do that to you, by the way. Depression will take you to the point where the only thing that you can see is you. It's the only thing you can see is yourself and your own problems. Do you know how God cures this? He does so with nutrition. He does so with rest. But he does so also with work. Then the Lord said to him, "Go and return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus." Get back to work. Activity. Get up and do something useful. Be a man. Be a Christian. Get back to work. And he does. That's it. He gets back to work. When we look at these three different examples, we see that if we look at them as not having just left God, but in our sense, kind of leaving the church, that Adam leaves the church because he thought he committed a sin that was far too big to be forgiven. That he'd taken a step too far. He left because he started to see God in a different light. No longer as a God of love, but a tyrant and an oppressive ruler, even though he'd never really been given any reason to believe that about God. Have you ever seen people like that? Maybe you've even been people like that, where you allow your own sins to shape how you see God. Hagar, she left the church because of the way that people treated her, because she couldn't get along with the leadership. She didn't agree with all the politics and the arguing over which son was going to be the next pastor or the next president of the institution. And so she looked outside the church. She looked back to the life that she left before she came in. She looked back to her hometown, to Egypt, and she thought, you know what, maybe I'll find happiness there instead. Elijah left the church because he was scared of what might happen if he stayed. The people outside the church were persecuting him for his beliefs. He left because within the church he felt lonely, ostracized, isolated. Because he felt like no one was really on fire like he was. Because the rest of God's people weren't keeping up. They weren't really doing the work as it should be done. They left. They left the faith, or they died, and he has no friends other than the fact that God said there are thousands out there that are doing my work. And you think you're the only one. All three of them could have been rebuked. All three of them deserted God, deserted his mission, deserted his people. All three could have been punished. But instead, God said, "I'm going to go to the heart. Why are you here? Where have you come from? Where are you going? Where are you?" And so when we get to Matthew chapter 26, this is the question being asked to Judas. And what did we say it means when God asks questions? That there's still hope. That perhaps Jesus at this moment saw a little creak, a little gap in the door to Judas's heart. Maybe there's still a chance. Judas, why are you here? Where have you come from? Where are you going with this? The fact that he's asking him, "Friend, why have you come?" For me, just completely epitomizes God's grace. Because it is a rhetorical question. Jesus knows the answer. He wants Judas to be sure of the answer. It's incredible that even after the betrayal, even after the contract has been signed, that Jesus still sees Judas as a friend. He's asking his friend, "Friend, what has brought you to this point? How have you got to the point where you're willing to not only leave your master, but betray your master? Why are you here?" And so the question is asked to you, why are you here, friend? Why have you come? Judas, can't you see, even though you've chosen to do evil, look around. I'm still here. Do you know who you're in the presence of? You're in the presence of God. In the question, I think maybe there's still a chance that Jesus is looking at this as a last gasp opportunity to get through to his friend, forever the optimist. And the reason why I think this is because I believe that whenever you're in the presence of God, there is always a chance of redemption. That's why the Word of God is so important. Because when you're in the presence of God, there's always a chance of redemption. That's why God's church as a physical thing is so important, because when you're in the presence of God, there is a chance for redemption. It's Judas's last chance to fall at the feet of Jesus and beg for forgiveness. But he doesn't. You can imagine the disciples must have thought, there's no way that you could follow Jesus so closely that you could see all his teachings and all his miracles. There's no way that you could experience firsthand in the very presence of Jesus his love and not be one. You see, they assumed, as we often do, that walking with Jesus is enough. It's not enough. It is not enough to simply walk with Jesus. That's not what we're called to do. We are called to surrender to Jesus. And there is a difference. I'll illustrate it like this. I don't really care for flowers. Doesn't really do it for me. They're beautiful, but like I don't like grow flowers at home or do anything like that. Some people see flowers and they're like, wow. I think I've just been desensitized. I tried once. I was a kid, maybe like 10 years old. And I got some sunflower seeds. And I put them in pots. All the pots were the same size. I put the same soil in all of those pots. I put the same amount of seeds in all of those pots. I put all of those pots in the same place on the windowsill so they'd all get the same amount of sunlight. I gave all of those pots the same amount of water every time necessary. And I did that for a couple of weeks. And then I noticed something. That some of those pots sprouted. I had 6 pots. 5 of them sprouted. 1 of them didn't. He received nothing different. The same soil, the same nutrients, the same sunlight, the same water, as all the rest. You know what the difference was? Biologically speaking, that the seeds that sprouted, they actually took hold of the nutrients around them and took them in. And that's what caused them to grow. It is possible to be around the nutrients. It is possible to be around the Word of God. It is possible to be surrounded by genuine Christians. It is possible to read the Word of God every single day and night and not grow. Because there is a difference between walking with Jesus and letting Jesus live in you. Amen. It is not enough to be at Heartland. You're not going anywhere special because you're here. You're not definitely going to heaven because you enrolled here. You're not definitely going to find Jesus because you enrolled here. It is up to you as an individual to make the most of that which surrounds you if you truly want to grow. Because I have seen countless times as students come in and they all receive the same nutrients. They receive the same literal food. They receive the same spiritual food. They receive the same love, the same amount of time, the same amount of attention, and some blossom and they flourish and they grow and they're strong and now they're feeding others. And then I've seen people just die, spiritually speaking, because they neglected to take in what they were given. You have an opportunity to answer that question. Why are you here? Are you here for the same reasons that Judas was here? For selfish gain? For position? For title? Maybe if I work my way through, maybe I'll get like a really good position at some, you know, big Adventist media company. Oh, then I'll be set. You won't be, by the way. Pay peanuts. Or maybe this way, you know, if I come here and I sit under this person and learn from this person, then maybe I'll achieve something, Jen. Maybe I'll be successful. Why are you here? Because if you're here for any other reason but knowing God, just go home. Just go home. Just visit the enrollment office or whatever. Just say, look, this isn't for me. I'm sorry. Be honest. Be genuine. Save yourself the pain. Don't go the whole way to the end like Judas did. If this isn't for you, head out. Call it a day. Jesus said the same thing to his disciples, by the way, in John chapter 6. At the end of his long sermon, after he just fed so many people, then he told them straight to their face, listen, if you want any part with me, you're going to have to eat my flesh. You're going to have to drink my blood. Do you know what's required? And they all left, bellies full. And then he looked at his disciples right at the end of the chapter, John chapter 6, verses 51 and 52. He looked at his disciples and said, will you leave also? The door's open. Head out whenever you feel like. Just, you can go. You know what Peter says in response to that? Two things. Lord, where would we go? Where would we go? We believe that you are the Son of God. And my friends, that is the only thing that when it comes to the end of time, that is the only thing that is going to keep you where you need to be. Not the institution that you went to, not the degree that you got, or the position that you occupy. The only thing that will be sufficient at that time, the only reason why you won't walk out that door is because you believe in your heart of hearts, you have no doubt in your mind that Jesus Christ is the Son of God and that He came here successfully to save you. That He's the Son of God. That's it. No one cares if you know the 2300-day prophecy. No one cares. Boo-hoo. I don't care if you know that Babylon fell and then Medo-Persia came and then Greece. No one cares about that. No one cares. No one cares that you know what the mark of the beast is. No one cares that you know it's not a microchip or a barcode. These are the least important things. Coincidentally, there are people that don't know what the mark of the beast is that will never receive it. And there are people that know exactly what it is that will sign up at the front row. Because the issue is not and has never been knowledge. Knowledge has never kept anyone. The issue is your heart sold out for Jesus? That's it. If it's sold out for Jesus, then the knowledge can come and be correctly applied. We've puffed ourselves up for so long on the fact that as Adventists, we know things. What does it matter if you know things if you don't know Jesus? What is the point of prophecy if it is not pointing to Jesus? The moral purpose of prophecy, to cause the day star to arise in your heart. Amen. But yet we confound ourselves with biblical arithmetic. Oh, well, you see, if you start on this date and you add this, then it's this, and that's why you should become an Adventist. Love those people to death. Make friends with them. Hang out with them. Get to know them. Become acquainted with their griefs and sorrows. Don't just leave a glow track on their window. Reach them. Love them. Ask them the questions. Genuinely. When they are your friend. Why are you here? Tell me your story. Where have you come from? Where are you planning on going? Friend, why are you here now, at this time in Earth's history? Why have you come? That's Christ's method alone. To win the heart and then to bid them to follow him. There's a fantastic story, which I'm sure some of you have heard. The great author Eric B. Hare. Any fans? He tells this amazing story, which I think is entitled The Joy at the End of the Road. And he talks about, and I won't go into it all, but I do encourage you to read it, this great separation that happened in this time of trouble, where he says that the good and the evil were divided naturally, kind of like the sheep from the goats. He said, as there was this great crisis and the people fled for their lives, they reached a camp and there was one camp on the left and one camp on the right. And he said, it was like magic, as if someone was standing in the middle saying, you go to the left and you go to the right. The people just naturally divided. He said it was incredible because he said all the people that loved the Lord went to one side. And all the people that didn't went to the other. And he said sometimes the people that were on the other side would venture over to see what it was like. And they would get there and they would hear them singing hymns and praising God. And they would be like, oh, that's horrible. I don't want to be over there. And they went back to their comforts, to their booze and their liquor and their lifestyle. He describes this terrible occasion, and deliverance was on the way. Some buses were coming to take them to a train station where they could get far away from the problems that were surrounding their nation. And so he said that morning when they heard that the buses were coming, all the people from the other side, they rushed to the front line. They were angry, they'd been arguing with one another, they were drunk and hungover from the previous nights. And they stood at the front line with their suitcases. And along came this bus amidst a cloud of smoke. Came out just kind of rummaging through the ground. And it stopped. And being at the front, they pushed the other people back. The people that loved the Lord, they pushed them back. And they said, this one's for us. There's another one coming. You guys can get the other one. And so they piled their suitcases in. And they're kind of squashed in there like sardines in a tin can. Pressed up against the window, no space, but there they are. And the bus heads on to the destination. And then a few minutes later, another bus comes. Except this bus is much bigger. And it's in much better condition. And when it stops, the people get off the bus and they take the people's luggage, although they don't have much, and they store it. And everyone sits there and they get inside and they all have a seat, and there's AC blowing in their faces, and they're just like, ah. Oh. And the bus heads on its way. A few miles on the road, they see up ahead a cloud of dust. And as they approach and as they get closer, they notice that it's the first bus. And it's broken down on the side of the road. And there they are, driving past. And their bus kind of slows down as they pass it. And they see all the people pushed up against the window. Help us! We should be on that bus! Let us get out and let us get in your bus! And their hands are out the windows wailing, and they're shouting and screaming. And as the bus passes by, they start cursing them and calling them names. And they just keep on going by. And the dust cloud gets a little bit bigger. And Eric B. Hare writes that at that moment, God gave him a glimpse of the end of time, where his people are safely taken to where they need to go. And he said, behind him, in a cloud of smoke that ascended up seemingly forever and ever, he saw the wailing hands of those that will be lost forever, shouting curses at the people of God. And he said that if one thing hit him, it was this. He said that if you wanted to stand with God at that time, then you have to stand with him now. You cannot disregard and forget God and not have him in your life for all of this time, and then right before the end, just jump on board. Friends, if you want to stand with God now, then you have to stand with him now. If you want the ability to make the decision, the strength in your mind to choose God when every logical thing is telling you to look after yourself and your family in that time instead of trusting the word of the Lord, then you need to be making those decisions now. Why are you here, Hartland? Why are you here, staff, faculty? Why are you here, students? I hope and pray for you that the reason is so that you can know Jesus. Because, friends, the time is coming very soon when the question that offers so much hope will no longer be offered. The time for questioning is running thin. We are fast approaching a time of judgment. And when we reach that point where, God willing, we're standing before Jesus, he's not going to ask us why we're here. He's going to tell us, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into my joy. That can be all of our realities. If you want it to be yours, I'm not going to ask you to stand or come to the front, because this is not time for a mere outward show. If you want that to be yours, then stand with Jesus in your heart today. Choose to be his today. And if you are able to make that choice today, then you're able to make that choice tomorrow, and the day after that, and the day after that, and the day after that. And if you're choosing to stand with God today, I have no doubt that you'll be standing with him in the end. Today, that is your choice to make. Why are you here? Let the answer be for Jesus. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we're so grateful for your boundless love. It seems to me when I read the scripture, Lord, that you are fascinated with us. That we truly are the apple of your eye. That you, Lord, know the very hairs that are on our head. You know us inside out. You know all of the sin and iniquity that has tarnished our names, our hearts. And yet you still come to us asking redemptive questions. You still want to know where we are, how we're doing. You want to save us. Even after all of this, you still call us friend. I pray, Lord, that our hearts would be won by your love and that we would stand with you both now and at the end of time. Thank you for being our friend. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.